The starting point is, this idea due to Maperci, to Mendel, that what we see phenotypically, the constituents of what we see are something which we don't see, right? That like it's like in the usual matter, you see atoms, but you don't, or rather their manifestations, but not of the what they're made of, right? Not of the subatomic particles. So, and here, the observable features associated to genes, but each gene composed of two or many, for the diploidal organism, of two or many units, and the A, B, and you write it like polynomial A, B, and what you observe is a function of it, right? So it's the observable certain function of these two variables, and so you don't concerned with what this function is, we're only concerned with this component. So this kind of, maybe more of them, maybe C. If it's each of them, you think about this kind of variable. If you see it, it will be like that. And you have distribution of them in the population. And so you have this kind of sum. Weights, yeah, A, B, C. A, B, C. So these are kind of formal variables, and you have polynomial in these variables. And when you think about what happens under randomly matching population, so what they exchange, right? They don't exchange their whole genes, but only these kind of gametes. And when you just formalize, and was done, I think, by Mendel implicitly and more explicitly by Hardy in special case, you arrive at the class of interesting dynamical systems, and then you can kind of forget where they came from. And so let me summarize what are these systems. So they work in some topological algebra, and in the case of genetics, it will be truncated polynomial algebra. So you consider polynomials in many variables divided by polynomials with degrees in each variables less than something, say one in this case, but maybe anything, yeah? And they take this ideal generated by certain monomial, you divide by them, and you have this truncated polynomial algebra. And this is quite shaped algebra. In particular, I want to say one property of this algebra, which is implicit in computation and genetics, and if you don't make it implicit, it's rather complicated, it has exponential map. So in this algebra, the exponential map from this algebra to itself, which are more surjective. So if you have polynomial starting with positive free term, they are in the image. So you have log. But if you look at this property of the exponential, write explicitly, it's not that obvious. Yeah. But it's quite remarkable feature of this algebra that additive and multiplicative groups are the same, which is implicit in genetics. And so, now what are these transformations? So transformation go in two stages. First, the random morphisms of A to A. Then you have product of them. In fact, so how these random morphisms come to life in examples? For example, here, because so this algebra is typically algebra of functions somewhere. So it acts on a space, and the morphisms come from maps of the space. In the case of Mendelian dynamics, you have Euclidean space, and you have coordinates, and you just have projections of coordinate subspaces. And these projections give you an endomorphism of your algebra, of course, right? And actually, it's not, and this endomorphism, by the way, have interesting, nice feature, it's important, by the way, yeah? This is also has some consequences. So you see that the whole story started when biologists realized that the Mendelian logic, and it was implicit in Mendel, tells you that variation stops in this second round of reproduction. So you have a mixed population, it being mixed, now you have new kind of population with different phenotype, but when you mix again, the distribution of phenotype doesn't change. So this slogan of if it survives, doesn't apply. It just happens only once, and that's it. Nobody dies anymore. I mean, just and this why it was so kind of people around Darwin were so much unhappy because completely destroyed everything they were saying, justifiably, because what they were saying was not correct. And then just behind this, on the first level, is just projection to the coordinates, have its property squared equal 1. Second, on the second level, you multiply these endomorphisms. And so then you have new kind of maps. They are multiplicative endomorphisms of the algebra, not of the algebra, but of its multiplicative group. And they are, as I said, quite non-trivial and quite amusing maps. It's just the objects which you obtain, and typical map of this type, which I want to kind of again bring to the light because it's quite remarkable. These are called Segre maps, and the most kind of remarkable is the first Veronese map. It is a map from projective space Pn to the sphere across a few dimension n plus 1 over n over 2 at this. But anyway, it is obtained by taking linear form on a linear space. Take linear form and take it square and become quadratic form. So you map space of linear form, one linear space, to another space with space of quadratic forms. And the image of the projective space, because symmetric sphere factors to projective space, you have projective space, the simplest example, you have S2, it goes to projective 2, and then goes to the sphere S4 in alpha. Yeah. And this quite, if you think, in quite remarkably symmetric sphere sitting there, it's orbit of the orthogonal group, even of the linear group. And this next level. So inside of this already, we have this here. The point, all the symmetry enters because we assume independence of events. So independence is assumption of symmetry. It's not just from philosophical point of view, it means something independent. Mathematically, it means you assume things are as symmetric as they can be. And this, why all the symmetry immediately comes in. And then the next level, this concerns a single gene, a single locus. And this kind of the maps we show get this way, these multiplicative endomorphisms, they have the property that also, this multiplicative endomorphism M, also they have this Mendelian kind of maps, which Mendel emphasized, square equals M. So if you look at a fixed particular phenotypic feature associated with one gene, its distribution population changes on the first round of random mating. It has nothing to do with selection. Yeah. So what you observe in population is variation, which Darwin and other people observing has nothing to do with selection. It's just mixing of present gametes. And then on the next level, when you have these M's, you consider some particular convex combination. In this moment, with J. Yeah? In this moment, some analysis enters. Because convex combination numbers must be positive. Otherwise, nothing works. I mean, you don't get anything manageable. And this combination corresponds when you have several genes in this kind of combination. Now it doesn't stabilize. The Dutch map doesn't stabilize, but it exponentially converges. And the reason of that, again, the kind of maps you see in this example. So here, your fundamental endomorphism projection to linear spaces. Out of them, you make other things, and they are invariant at the very big symmetry group, and actually it's exactly what Fields call a normalization group, because of the symmetry, you can control them pretty well, and the basic result here, that this map, well, you have to look what condition they satisfy, which I explained, the really simple condition you need to satisfy, that there is a unique fixed point in this map, it's equilibrium position, and it is a fixed point, it's attractive, exponentially attractive fixed point. And this is seen because just once you know it's locally attractive, and because there is big normalization group, its differential is attractive, then you know it's attractive in direction transversal to equilibrium position. So everything goes to subspace of equilibrium maps. And the equilibrium maps are the one which maximize the entropy. And at this moment, entropy enters. And just a couple of words now in biology that should be said, that this feature this fundamental property of sexually producing organisms, that it's not features which are inherited, but the secret units of gametes inside, which are invisible, which are inherited, ensures stability of populations. If not for that, we'll all be dead pretty soon. We would degenerate. Again, elementary mathematics shows that we would die. Nothing would be there. So if you take naive Darwinist theory, use mathematics, boom, we are not there, we are dead. And this is very easy, kind of easy mathematics, because it would be accumulation of deleterious mutation, and they will beat you eventually. Any population, when there is no horizontal gene exchange, when there is no sexual reproduction, it tends to degenerate, of course, time dependent, depends on the scale. But essential here, which makes them incomparably more stable, that population keeps units which are not manifested themselves in the, so if they become somewhat deleterious, some other will compensate. And this is really a completely different game. I haven't looked carefully in this mathematics. And so in any case, in genetics, there are two time scales. One, the one which I described from Mendel, then long scale, the latter which correspond to mutations, because these A's and B's may subject to certain modifications, which are not at all kind of trivial what they are. They're not just random something. In the traditional evolution theory, they were confused by some people at that time, and kind of become clear, really transparent relatively recently. There was some clarity that has been achieved, but it may be deceptive because, say, it was happening many times. When Darwin came with his theory, everybody was, at least those who were supporting him, were very happy and saying, oh, now we understand evolution. And then next generation came with Mendel, and then mathematics by Haldane and Fisher and Wright, who developed mathematical formalism and say, oh, no, this was complete nonsense, now we understand it. And this was called modern evolutionary synthesis, about in the 20s and 30s. And then in the 70s, the molecular biology started, and Manoah was a great, kind of one of the great biologists of this time, said that, well, now we understand evolution on the molecular level. And he was extremely kind of sarcastic about everybody else, you know, people out of biology speaking about evolution and saying they understand something there, because they, in his opinion, justifiably, then understood nothing. But now we say that Manon understood as little, because his ground was very few data. And now we say, now we understand, and the reason is because the data on molecular goes on the petabyte basis, something like trillions of units of petabyte, keep forgetting, maybe it's even quadrillion, yeah? The number of total amount of lengths of sequences now being analyzed, I think, of the order of 10 to the 15 or something. Yeah, this petabyte. So this is a data from which you now can make some non-trivial statement about evolution, what happens. And if you have, you know, something like 10 to the 5, which wasn't the type of mono, yeah, it's nothing. You cannot make, it's incomparable. So, and now people say, well, now we understand something, right? One can reconstruct the common ancestor of all living organisms, which lived about 3.5 billion years ago. But on the other hand, it is explicitly stated now that we understand nothing. It's a tiny little piece of the situation, infinitely more complicated than people believed in 200 years ago, 100 years ago. So that's concerning that. And now I want to return to the entropy, because it enters here, and it's, so the point, one last point, that, so this was very special kind of endomorphisms, and mathematically immediately you ask, what are other transformations of this kind available when you have an algebra and have this kind of dynamics in there? And other examples what they are, and another pronounced example is, of course, the normal law. So the normal law is exactly come from the same time. You have algebra of functions under convolution. You take this convolution squared, and the thing becomes rescaled. So you scale it correctly. And this always, by the way, the rescaling is essential, all these things. You never have, on the polynomial level, where you have rarely, almost never have it important. And And then you have a fixed point, and you know it has a huge attractive base, and this is a normal law. And the question is, what happens for other fixed points of these transformations? Yeah? Which of them is sufficiently attractive, and what are similar transformations involved? And I think, I don't know how much has been studied in that. Yeah? And of course, there are many other algebras and many other examples immediately coming to my mind, but coming to one's mind, but I haven't looked at them. Yes. Even here, yes, yeah, you only, yeah, as I said, there are lots of other mathematics, and but the point is, if you want to make mathematics, you have to a little bit separate yourself from reality, because of course this ideal genetics never satisfied. On the other hand, this is exactly because this mathematics is useful, because you can understand what it is and at least roughly use it. What typically in this population dynamics, you can see the more general kind of mating. And this mating is usually just more or less general, if you don't say something, quadratic map from Euclidean space to itself, yeah. This is a quadratic map. And then what? Nothing. Quadratic map is just anything. Any polynomial map may be seen as quadratic map because all kind of algebraic operation generated by summation and multiplication, so it's of degree 2. So everything is quadratic. So everything can be there, and how can it say where kind of is what you want? So that's the problem. On the other hand, you can imagine other models, for example, of evolution with sufficiently separated scales. Of course, another feature here, which is very non-physical, which is opposite to what we shall see in a second, it's scale separation. Separation, all biology depends on the fact that there are many separate scales. And mathematics of that is related, at least part developed, to what is called tropical geometry. But again, I haven't looked at this myself carefully, and even what I looked at, I don't want to discuss here. But now I want to turn to entropy and do the similar thing. So we have this very naive starting point was we have two groups of organisms, two fields of flowers of a different color. They were separated, they mixed up, and we see distribution of colors and see how it develops, and see it kind of stabilizes too fast to be counted by biology, mathematical phenomenon. Now, and mathematics here is kind of amazingly kind of ready. Basically it's algebra and homomorphism, the homomorphism, something quite nice. Symmetries, Lie group, actually symmetries here, this randomization are typically nilpotent Lie groups, etc. It's ready. Now what happens with physics, yeah? So because Boltzmann and Mendel were almost contemporary. Boltzmann was slightly younger than Mendel, but of course he never heard of Mendel. And they pursued the same idea that the fundamental world is discrete rather than continuous, right? So Mendel shown that basic units of inheritance are discrete, and this again is saying with the in opposite to basic premises of Darwinian theory, and so Mendel was right and Darwin was wrong at every point, but and Boltzmann was insisting that the world was discrete on the level both of structure and energy. So he suggested that atomic theory was, of course, conjectured long before him, but he was promoting it. And also he suggested energy is discrete. And this was because of his suggestion he made to Planck. And the Planck has now introduced his Planck constant in discreteness of energy. So, but what is kind of the model? What is the mathematics he was trying to pursue? And so what's amusing about that, again, this mathematics, which you have this physical or biological very simple scheme, but mathematics, you take it the one you know. Scheme is always the same, but your interpretation depends on your background. Yeah? So what is the logic of Boltzmann? So we have the system of particles. Yeah. But at that time, atoms were kind of semi-conjectural. Yeah. And some people still didn't believe in atoms. Justifiably, yeah, because as we know today, atoms in the classical framework cannot exist. It's just an absurd notion, yeah. They only make sense in the terms of quantum mechanics, otherwise it's just self-contradictory concept. But still you can pretend they're there. And then you want to understand it's a system consisting of many atoms. And you want to assign to it entropy. Entropy, of course, was coming from physics in a different plane, but we just stick to the ideology of Boltzmann, and as physics, you can read in physics text, entropy is just log of the number of states. And this just try to decipher it, yeah? Try to decipher it. So what is, you have the system and what it states and what are the, so what it means. So you can say, aha. This is how it was done by mathematicians of that time. The interpretation was coming along with Cantor theory of sets, and actually Cantor theory also very much in the spirit, yeah, just you well built with basic units, elements of sets. So you say, aha, there is a set of states, and this is log of the cardinality of this space. Right, so we have all possible position of these atoms, and then the immediate objection is kind of infinite set, it has no cardinality, it will be infinity, it just doesn't work. But of course, this is because we already try to read this in the language which is not appropriate here. So just what I want to explain, that the way people were treating Boltzmann till recently was just completely arbitrary. It was the language. So for me, the kind of turning point of the language will be somewhere 1960 for this particular purpose. I would say, so pre-Grothendieck or post-Grothendieck. Of course, there were other people involved. And particularly in this story, it was also, well, people accompanying Grothendieck in categorical thinking. And then another point was around this time, which developed, but it was non-standard analysis, yeah, which didn't exist before. And so what Boltzmann was saying can be interpreted completely rigorously in terms of non-standard analysis and categorical language mixed together, right? So all these infinities, whatever, relate to concept of the space of states. But there is no space of states. I mean, this is an abstraction. Mathematicians may say it, but you may say, well, it's just not there. There is no such thing. And so what actually physicists have, right? Just how what they observe and how interpret what they observe. And this would let me explain it, and then how we transform it to the language of into post-Grothendieck language. And so what you observe and is as follows. So I have this physical system. For Boltzmann, it was a gas. I prefer it to be a crystal, right? It just for the purpose of the discussion, it's slightly easier. And so it's a crystal. So you think about it secretly, but then you don't know what it is. It's just atom positioned in a lattice, in a symmetric pattern in the space. And this is a three translation making this group G3. But you don't know that. Right, just your mental picture. So what you do is start measuring it. So you take some machine, you put it here, and see what you see. And then it's another physical system, it has its own states, and you think about this, it's something with windows. And then something blinking in these windows. In this, and this, and this, and this. Then you take another such machine, put it somewhere else, and you have the same blinking. And you can move it along in this space, and see what happens, and again, they blink together. And this is what all you see. And moreover, even you don't have colors, whatever. You only have frequencies of blinking. And if you can move one machine to another by translation of the space, you say they're kind of really the same, and then you can compare corresponding windows. And from that, you develop concept, and this, the only thing physicists have is entropy. And yes, immediately what I say, my description will be not quite complete. I describe it in categorical terms, but probably the right language will be two categories, because there is in fact protocol of how you do that. And these protocols are morphism in two categories. And that probably better kind of formalism. So the right, not right, but simple and more adequate formalism from Grothendieck point of view would be the one which I'm going to describe. So what is entropy? What is this physical system? Right? And I want to say that there is no set. Eventually, there is no set here. There is entropy, but there is no space of states. You have number of states, but there is no space of states. And this number in this log must be understood in a way in an appropriate way, exactly kind of translating what Boltzmann says into the language of first into categorical language, and secondly into language of non-standard analysis, which actually the right object is some growth in the group is some non-standard completion of certain category. So, and this I want to explain. And this extremely simple thing is just this, just words. It's just words. You just translate what I said. So what? Again, we don't know what system is, but we have attached to these little things, these kind of windows, and you see this blinking. And sometimes you can move it, and sometimes you can have them together. This and then some other attached. And then each of them is a physical system in its own right, and you can attach to it a smaller one and see what you see from this one. So you make this, all physicists, we have this machine put here, and this machine connect to this machine. Do that, and so what is the category you get? I'm saying it is describing very simple category, which is a kind of kindergarten category, but if you just say in these terms, everything becomes extremely straightforward, and this basic category is of finite measure spaces. It's a very simple category, which is objects are stones, like finite collection of stones with given weight, normalized to have total weight 1. So measure you measure them in units. And morphism, when bringing, or better to say, as I said before, not stones, but drops of water. They drink them together. Some of them you can bring together. And this, and their mass adds. So these are morphisms. And immediate objection maybe is just like partially already said why to have category, but we shall see in a second that it's extremely advantageous to think, even in this example, to speak in categorical terms. Now, about entropy. Maybe I say before going to entropy, I just a little bit go ahead and then return back to entropy. This is our finite spaces corresponding to these little machines, which have finitely many entries, and you have frequencies of some blinking here. And these frequencies, relative frequencies, are our weights. So our measure space is it. Our morphisms, when we go from one to smaller one, right? But then there is this big one, which is not of this nature, right? The original physical system is not like that. It's kind of infinite, yeah? These are finite, there are finitely many windows, and there are blinking there, so weights are these frequencies. And again, when you look at this through kind of these limited means, for example, you only count blinking here and here, you have this morphing from one finite measure space to another. What about the big one, right? So the big one, the one you measure by means of the small ones, and you know perfectly well what it is in categorical language, it is covariant functor from this category of finite measure space to category of sets. Period. I mean, just you don't have to think. You know what it is. I mean, there are this language, if you know this, you do it effortlessly, and then you go on. And just all measure theory, as we know it, comes effortlessly from there. All statements and theorems and proofs of measure theory are part of this categorical language. So this language is whoop, like flow. You just say all standard sentences, absolutely trivial, without thinking, in all measure theory in your hands. Once you have this category. And this category is just kindergarten. And this is what people do in measure theory usually, but their language is 19th century language, and this creates problem. And historically, so the point is interesting, and I think for me justification that this language is bad was that entropy, who was in the dynamical system invented by Kolmogorov, I keep forgetting, 1558, his first paper contained mistakes. Yes, in this context, it's so trivial and clear how there is no room for mistakes. Exactly because he was using his own language, he created also measure theory. It's a modern measure theory language, and this language is not adequate here. It just creates only problem. It's just a weight you carry with you. It's absolutely unnecessary, and you make mistakes. Of course, ideas, he had completely right ideas, and ideas are like that. They're kindergarten ideas. But the language is very awkward. And so when you write it, you just, you know, because it's complete ballast you carry, and so you make mistake in this ballast because it's ballast. That was corrected by Sinai, and so it's called Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy. But this again concerns this ballast, it doesn't concern the core, which is what I said. Now, we still now turn to the entropy. So eventually, the point is to understand what is the entropy of this kind of physical system, like our crystal, and in these terms. So, the point of again, physical idea of entropy, it's something which you measure many, many times, and then you average, and then you get it. The typical the formula which you write for the finite measure space would be sum pi log pi. When, right? On the other hand, if you look at this picture, you measure something here, then you take identical thing and measure it again, and take identical thing to measure it again, and look at the coherence of these measurements. This was extremely kind of messy stuff. But however, and if you want to count this number of states, you have to kind of repeat experiments too many times. On the other hand, there is very concise formula, and that's exactly the formula. It's not definition of entropy. It's very efficient way to compute it, suggested by Boltzmann and mistook for the definition by mathematicians, because they were doing in 19. Actually, this was not Boltzmann, it's Planck who first wrote this formula. And but it's again, it's a formula. It's not just computational formula, not a definition. So what would be the definition? So I give you first kind of the mode of this definition. I then decipher it again. So I have my category of finite measure spaces, called FM, finite measure spaces. So this certain category. If you have any category, you can assign to it a Grothendieck group or Grothendieck semigroup, right? So we shall do that, but shall do it with certain care, right? But this we have this in the back of our mind, but we do it with some care. And this means that whenever we have, so this is preferably assigned to morphisms, right? And so it's something. So we take a group generated formally by morphism or semigroup, and the relation, if you compose FG, then this element in the Grothendieck group will be F plus G. So it's abelian group or semigroup. I prefer semigroup in this context, like that. Very simple. I mean, it's abelianization of your category. And in the first approximation, entropy is of a finite measure space, it's image in this Grothendieck group, and that's it. But then, a posteriori, this group or the semigroup is isomorphic, as topological. Actually, this category also has some topology in it, which I suppressed at this moment. Yeah, I somewhat suppressed this, but this will come in a second otherwise. If you just say it like that, it will be huge abelian group or semigroup, uncountable, something horrible. Yeah? But still, by the way, not if you just limit it to special space, it's still not completely absurd. But it's topological, so you only look, do everything continuously. But in any case, I want just to kind of bypass this and just to come closer to the core of this to explain actually how it works and how to look at this in a somewhat different perspective. That's kind of the idea. Because in fact, the correct statement, it is not Grothendieck group of this category, but of a non-standard model of this category. Right? So given any kind of finite category, and we shall return to this. This is kind of comes to the more modern result in ergodic theory, when you have to work with this non-standard model of groups and small categories. But now I want to look at this in a more naive way, and just for me, it is the following example, which I love very much. It surprised me a lot when I learned it. And this is a Lewis, I'm not sure I say it correctly, Lewis-Whitney inequality. And this inequality, so again, I already said, spoke about it, and I want to repeat it again, where this idea is extremely clear and again forces you to think about other mathematical problems. you consider as a measurable set in the Euclidean space, in three-dimensional space. It's true in any dimension, but this is the first non-trivial example. And you consider three projections to coordinate planes. So it is x, y, z plane. And you can see the x, y projection, x, z projection, and y, z projection. So you have three domains. And this has certain volume, and this have certain area, x, y, a, x, z, and a, y, z. And then the inequality says, not surprisingly, that volume squared less or equal than product of these three. And this is a weak, I mean sharp, but not sharp in certain sense, form of isoperimetric inequality. Because if you have a domain and you know bound on area, of course, area of each of them smaller than area, right? And this is the volume. So I have volume as a correct power estimation of area, except the extremal shape here will be not a ball, but a cube, right? Which is somewhat amusing because this is a isoperimetric inequality. Even in this sharp form, it's very kind of powerful inequality. It implies, for example, all Sobolev inequality is half mathematical physics, trivial corollary of this. And so how you prove that? And this is the proof by Whitney and Lewis was just writing some simple computation with Hölder inequality, which it's very easy and what? It's kind of strange. But the right way, in my view, the right way to think about this is as follows, which is explain this Grothendieck philosophy. You observe that first that it has nothing to do with Euclidean space. All was essential that you had product of three measure spaces. Or maybe I call them according to my annotation x, y, and z. And I have a subset there. And I project it to x, y, y, z, etc. And look at these measures and I have this inequality. I never use here the structure of the Euclidean structure because everything about measurable sets and measures theoretically, it's all the same. Actually, I speak here in measure theoretic language, which already I said is very bad language. Yeah? By the way, I said that measure space is a functor from the category of finite sets to the category of sets, which I didn't quite explain yet. But on the other hand, this language is kind of sticky. We still use it. Yeah, and there is a good reason not to use measure theoretic language because it's really not correct. The way just textbooks written in measure theory, they're just wrong. Everything they say is wrong because it's not a set. Measure space is not a set. It's category is not category of sets. If you say it's set, it's not a set. This must be. But on the other hand, you can't say set if you remember, if you know what you say. Okay. So, and once you say these words, yeah, you observe if I put here Cartesian powers, and nothing changes. Yeah, and all these numbers go to the nth power. Therefore, if you can prove this inequality for large n, even approximately with some error, when you take back n's root, you may get what you want. So what you have to prove only, it's approximately, but after you took the power. And now again, I say slightly uncarefully, and then come back to this in a second. Which will be not quite true what I'm saying, but almost. When you start going to high and higher power here, with the law of large numbers, this set, arbitrary set, will kind of converge to the cube. And so in the limit, you have this cube when you have a quality, which is not quite true, yeah, because exactly, I'm saying not quite right. It will be converged to the cube minus or plus something term in your favor. And then in the limit, you just say, huh, I have a quality, and I read this n, and I have the proof. And so it's completely effortless proof. And now, yes, if you think a little bit about that, so what happens when they're high in higher power and apply the law of large numbers? But now I want to formulate the law of large numbers because it motivates what I do. On the other hand, the definition with Grothendieck group, they don't need it. Yeah, it just comes in the end. So what is the point of the law of large numbers in this context? So it applies to finite measure spaces. So I have a finite measure space, which I want to write as a collection of atoms, yeah? Finite collection of atoms. It says if I take this Cartesian power of this, which means I, so it's kind of quite simple, right? I have this thing and have this thing, and in every one of them I put the product of the two. You remember there was exactly the essence of this most elementary Mendel type of map, yeah? It was exactly doing that. You remember how you, so it's, we are not quite far from where we were. So this Hardy-Weinberg theorem or Mendel kind of principle says if I take a matrix, and which is where the sum of all elements normalized equals 1, I replace every entry by product of sum here and the sum here, and normalize again the resulting matrix so the sum will be 1. So I have a space, I have a mapping from space of matrix into itself. The square of this map equals M. Yeah? This was kind of paradox resolved by Hardy and Weinberg in special case. Yeah. Though they never formulate in these terms. Yeah? They're just writing explicit formulas. I shown you last time this kind of rather stupid formula. But if you write a formula for 2x2 matrix, symmetric matrix. However, this is exactly what we are doing. This is a square of a space. Now we have this power. And the point of the Bernoulli theorem saying that when n goes to infinity, this space converges in some sense to space with equal entries, which I would call homogeneous spaces. I just equal entries, I don't want to say it because it depends on a particular category I'm speaking about. But being homogeneous object in the category is true always. Just for any category, this concept of homogeneous object A category. So every measure space, finite measure space, when you take it high power, become essentially homogeneous. And to say it precisely in a compact way, you have to say that I take P and take N being non-standard infinitely large number, and this space as a non-standard space is homogeneous up to higher order kind of infinitesimals. And this language, when you pursue it, you should see it's really how it works. Now, let me remind again what is the precise definition, in what sense it converges. And moreover, yeah, and this is what is essential. It's not only true for individual space, it's true for morphisms. So it works coherently. So given any kind of diagram of maps, you go to the high power, the whole diagram is approximated by a corresponding diagram where all spaces are homogeneous and morphism between homogeneous spaces. By the way, when the spaces are homogeneous and morphism are between those are just the composition of numbers, right? So we have equal atoms, you project it, preserving weights. So it means here you have number P times Q and here it's number P. So it's you throw away some factor. You decompose the numbers and the products. Right, so its category becomes extremely simple, just category of numbers and category of the multiplicative category of numbers. And I'm saying when n goes to infinity, this category converges to another category. So in the limit, and actually it's non-standard limit. I mean, it's, you shall see this formalism is essential. By the end of this lecture. Okay, so, but now let's say explicitly, because when you have to decipher it once, and then you can forget it, and speak in this kind of language, and we feel very comfortable. But once we have to say it explicitly in what sense converges, you don't have to know what non-standard analysis is, and this in a way it just says if you just follow your kind of naive intuition about infinitesimal whatever, you just do it right, as it was always done, and then the justification of that, which is, by the way, is not at all true justification because it depends on some axiomatics which may not be accepted, right? Some people wouldn't accept it. Okay, so what is the essential convergence? And there are two topologies involved. There are two type of equivalences, and they're really different. And I mean, you eventually mix them up, and one corresponds to additive structure and probability in numbers, and another to multiplicative. And the additive is very simple. When you have two measure spaces, two finite measure spaces, and another measure space, you say they are close, epsilon close, if one obtained from another by removing, co-edging subject of measure epsilon. It may be many, many atoms, but total mass epsilon, right? If you so yes, you don't change kind of. You take some bunch of atom of weight of one minus epsilon, and you do whatever you want to others. You spread them, condense them, whatever. So these two it will be additively closed by epsilon. And then there is another one, multiplicative, and here always can use is normalization. I hope I say it correctly. And that another one which you multiply everything by a constant, all atoms multiply by a constant, such that if you take I hope I'm not confusing it. You take divide log of the constant by the log of the number of elements in your space, this goes to zero. Again, everything applied for infinitely large n, so it must be infinitesimal. This is what I'm saying. It's very inconvenient all the time I speak about sequences. It's one n, but infinitely large, which means you work with sequences. But I'm always confused. You take log by c or you divide themselves. It's all, we shall see in a second. I'll formulate the law of large numbers and then become probably correct. Except here, there is one little point because you have two spaces. And they have different number of atoms, this m, by which one you divide. And you divide by a small one. But again, this is conventional. Because in truth, you have a sequence depending on n. And this is your kind of normalizing element. You divide by this n log n. Yeah? And this, I think, is a kind of essential point. Yet again, it goes in the direction of the large deviation, small deviation, I always forget how it's called, yeah.
Why do you call it additive?
No, because one is independent additive structure numbers here, multiply by number. I multiply always by number, and here I just add or subtract some mass, yeah. Probability theory exactly just is interplay between additive and multiplicative structure. They're very different here. Yeah. And the old proofs of equivalence here have to separately prove something invariant under additive and something invariant under multiplicative. And then when I have two sequences, two spaces, x and y, I take the powers and see if the two sequences for infinitely large n, if they are equivalent. And you call them Bernoulli equivalent. And Boltzmann entropy is a class of Bernoulli equivalent spaces. And by Bernoulli theorem, in a second I explain why, such a space for large n is homogeneous. And so it's the number of atoms, the number is kind of defined. So you take log of this number, it will be entropy, and they're Bernoulli equivalent if and only if entropies are equal. And if you compute this entropy by going there, you immediately see it's just kind of trivial. It is given by this formula. Yeah, I mean just because it's a kind of trivial computation because it both behave correctly under the problem. Now, why Bernoulli theorem? Why is the law of large numbers? It may usually the law of large numbers formulated differently, but it is the law of large numbers for variable log p. Yeah. But you can you don't have to say that, yeah. From a certain point of view, this is a better the law of large numbers than the usual one because it involves no extra random variable. It's just one measure space. It's a property of the category itself. And it doesn't, of course, it's might be careful. It's a little bit, of course, cheating because there are two measure spaces here, right? Secretly, it's this weight pi and the space with equal weights to all atoms. And of course, additionally with Boltzmann, for Boltzmann, there were two measure spaces. It was Euclidean space, which invariantly we will measure, and his second measure distribution of his ensemble and where the entropy came up. So it's in fact property of two measures where the entropy comes. Now?
So the usual law of large Some measure space with something fixed.
Yeah, it's a measure space with extra weight function, this which gives you second measure. And this was how Boltzmann think about that, and this is kind of Shannon interpretation. I don't know exactly how, because the way Boltzmann writes, of course, he doesn't say it explicitly. But in his arguing with mathematicians, of course, he shows he this what he had in mind. And he had in mind, of course, non-standard analysis all the time. And which was not, of course, available in a rigorous form. In fact, it wasn't well kind of established a century ago by Leibniz. But then came people, you know, like Weierstrass, you know, Cachet, and said it's not good, and changed it to epsilon delta. And of course, everybody thought in those terms. And so Boltzmann was just in the wrong moment. Yeah. So nobody understood what he was saying. I mean, mathematicians had tendency to misunderstanding what he was saying, or arguing with him in a rather silly way. Anyway, this is a point. Now I just want to explain this. So how we are using that, you establish basic inequalities. So what is the basic inequality? Is the Shannon inequality. So let me now just come back to this abstract measure space, and just though these inequalities are about finite measure spaces. So when you have this, so why abstract measure space? You have abstract measure space. In what sense? It defines the functor in the category of finite measure spaces. And the functor is extremely simple. It's just a set of maps from X. So if it's finite measure space AP, it's just a set of all measurable maps. We don't know what measurable maps are, but this what you do. Because category, you have this X is object of some category, and you know there are morphisms in this category. There is no points, and there is, you see, the point is there is no points, because in order to define usually measure space, you have to speak about all sets of measure zero, and the set of this is more than continuum. Therefore, you need to already all fully develop Zermelo-Frankel theory. And this certainly, I mean, just nobody, no mathematician knows this actually. Yeah? It's a very messy and pleasant theory, and who knows whether it's right or not. Right? It's logic. And it secretly sits there. Of course, you don't care, because it's, I'm saying, it's a load you carry which you don't need. You never use it. Right? All these measures. But as categorically, all you have to know is that. Is this for our purpose? And in classical language, and still very convenient pictures, partition into finitely many elements with different weights. But the point is, it's convenient categorically to give it a name like that and have a map into some P. And then it doesn't have to be a set, it's just a functor. And in another way to think about this, because it maps to all measure spaces, finite measure spaces, have this category of finite measure spaces, and it's convenient. In a second, we shall see, take a small subcategory, so it will be set, not just class. And here on the top, we have this X. And this can go to any space here. So you just, in the top of this pyramid, you bring this set. And so what's relevant, basic operation for sets, for partition, you can intersect them pairwise. And this operation is called, so we have this. We have two spaces on the X. You can say P times Q. And the meaning of that, if you have a physical system, and you measure it by one set state detector and take another one, you consider them simultaneously. So you consider how much frequencies appears in pairs of windows. And this will correspond to this operation. And you don't know, again, the whole point, you don't know what the big system thing is. You don't care, it's sets or no sets. It's just absolutely irrelevant. It's not set. It is a set of numbers, of course, it's just rather ad hoc abstraction. And it's just we're used to that in common. It's very useful, in a way, operation to consider a set of everything. Whichever you meet somebody, take a set of all of them. But as it seems that kind of experience of the last decade says, well, it's much better to do it categorically. I mean, it just gives you better language than set theory. Of course, it's just language, either of them. So, and this corresponds to this intersection, and this, again, have to define categorically. So what it means, so you have this functor, so you add this functor, consider an object of a category, and then it means the following. So you have X goes to P, X goes to Q, And then there is kind of a minimal object here, R. So you can split this diagram. And this category has this property. So this essential, this category of finite sets, finite measure spaces have this property when you add this. I said it incorrectly. So your measure space means you have a function with this property. So you always have this R. Yeah. And then you have all you have to know about measure spaces. Yes, everything can be said in this language in an extremely simple way. I mean, just everything translates here. Now, this is, by the way, interesting kind of pattern. Well, this R will be this.
That's the sum. What about the product?
No, this is actually a co-product. There is no only this operation. Other operation is silly from this point of view. There is another operation, but it's completely silly. I mean, it exists, but it's that theoretic and it's perversion, so to speak. Yeah. It enters in some level, you know, on a much more sophisticated level, but you can say it, but I better not to say. It's a needed to the structure. It's some artifact of something. Well, I'm not saying it's, you forget about that, but it's completely different level of much by two order higher level of abstraction, which is not needed here. So this is what we have. So we have this category, and now I want to formulate, prove, and explain kind of the basic inequalities. And the basic inequality here is this Shannon inequality, which says that P times Q, the entropy of that, less or equal that entropy of P plus entropy of Q. Okay. Now, again, it is physically kind of obvious, right? Because we make two observations and they count what you see, count number of possibilities. If you make them together, they don't interact, they don't prevent. For example, you may have kind of certain colors blinking here, and if they're completely here and here independently, of course, the numbers will multiply, so logs will add, right? But if they interact, some of them may prevent one from interfere with another, you have fewer number. And then for physicists, of course, that's obvious. Because already they have this picture of this being number of states. Now, how we can see this in this language? I'm saying, now we, because typically proof, what mathematicians do, write this entropy, some log is convex, and quite happy. I personally can't accept such, but I don't know why log is convex. You have to differentiate, you have to know calculus. You don't have to know that. You can translate this physical reasoning to categorical language and then become as obvious as that without, and in particular prove that log is convex. Right? So log is convex follows from this physical language. Yeah, it's not behind it. And the proof is as follows. When you have this inequality, you know, again, you can put here powers n. Because everything multiplicative. When everything multiplicative, everything becomes homogeneous. And then when it becomes homogeneous, it reduces to the statement. So let me I reformulate it slightly differently. Yes, if you formulate the original theorem, this inequality in terms of this two projection to P into Q, it says we have here some weights, and I project them here and here. Here is my P, here is my Q, and here is my R. So it's some measure here, one project here, and one projection here. And this is R. R meaning P, Q. And so this inequality says something about these matrices. So you have here is projection give you measure P, here is measure Q, entropy of P plus Q dominates measure of R. Now, if I take Cartesian power of all of them, they all become homogeneous. And what I see that this R will be subset in the product of P plus Q. And because cardinality of sets is monotone under injective maps, you have it. And this indeed somewhat strange, because in measure theory, all morphisms are surjective. And here you use the fact, you use injectivity of the maps. And this will be kind of fundamental in the, it's really kind of quite kind of not obvious thing, and this was kind of understood rather recently in the work by Lewis Boyne. Right? So actually, how does injectivity can be seen categorically? What is injective? And the point is that exactly this appears in this diagram. R going to P and R going to Q. This diagram is kind of injective. So when you go from the original category, look at the category of such kind of diagrams. And so the morphism now is a pair of morphisms. And this is a morphism. So if you take this for morphism of new category of this, of this flags, how they're called, yeah? Then this will be injection, and it will be injective morphism in the sense of category theory, right? So it's another way to formulate it, and this which suggestive for other kind of for other categories. So that's entropy is monotone for in the category of certain diagrams, right? Because you see, you have to go from surjective morphism to injective ones. And the proof, as I said, exactly like that, that this Shannon inequality tells you that. And another point, another inequality, Shannon inequality, is a more which you usually use, is slightly different. And it says that entropy of now for morphisms also says inequality. And this I want to show you at this moment advantages of these notations. So that's for morphisms, and just if you use usual definition. So in traditionally, this is called entropy of F, called relative entropy. And it's written like this, entropy of P, comma Q. For me, it's a morphism. F is a morphism from P to Q. The trouble with this notation, of course, you never know who is P and who is Q. And secondly, you have three symbols, P, comma Q, instead of one F. So just exactly three times formulas. You see, I exactly wrote it down to see. This. So what happens? So just half a line, exactly the line, yeah.
Meanwhile, can I ask a question about the formalism?
Yeah.
Are you allowing partially defined maps between your finite metric spaces?
Partially defined maps between the finite metric spaces?
Yeah.
In this context, not. But implicitly, they are there.
Because the measuring device, it seemed like that was just a part. You're only localizing in a certain.
No. You measure the whole thing. No. Measuring device measures the whole system. It measures the whole system. However, technically, it's convenient to have partially defined map, but they're not in this category. Okay. So as usual, because it's kind of slightly analytic, the categorical language must be slightly kind of readjusted. Yeah, and indeed, you have to allow partially defined maps just for to defining this topology in the limit. That it's needed, but category is just category as it is. In the defining its properties, okay. So you see the difference between the formulas over there and this how you write it when you write in digital term. Yeah, I see. Yes, this is easy to remember, and this certainly it's a mess, already unpleasant. But so if you make computations, it's a lot of difference. Yeah. Also. Relative entropy makes sense, was good about that, and was very typical for this logic categorical, even when entropies of individual P and Q makes no sense. Yeah. So in the simple thing, this entropy of this morphism difference of two entropies, if they exist. But it may happen that both P and Q are actually infinite spaces. And entropy of P and Q is not defined, but difference is. Yeah?
So just to follow up on this question, can you, instead of you're defining entropy for functions, and he asked if you could have partially defined functions.
No, they're morphisms. No, I don't function, they're morphisms. I don't know what function is. Well, in partial morphisms. Morphism, we have a category, we have morphism, period. They're not set.
You also have relation.
No. This is exactly wrong language. There is no relation, there are category and there are morphism, period. This is exactly the power of this language. You don't need this kind of junk. Yeah, partial sets, you don't need this junk. Yes, category and more very clean language.
No, in the end, if you have it for relations, you have it for the graph.
No, I don't have a graph. I don't have a graph. It's pure categorical language. This is the whole point. I insist. You can express everything in pure categorical language. You don't need set theoretic language. All business about relation, spatial sets, functions, they all poop out of there. You secretly have, because you're used to them, and keep them at the back of your mind. But I prefer to have it back on the mind, physical system.
You say there's no relations in categorical language?
No. I mean, you can, bring them, but they're kind of a junk. You see, the whole point of categorical language, it emphasizes the relevant relations and throw away the junk. And if that's the junk, you carry all this junk with you. And this year, you don't know what to do with this, it accumulates, right? And it's much more clean language. And not ideal, I guess. Not perfect, and it has some drawbacks here, and we shall see them in maybe today. It's not the end of the world, because one of the points you have to work in some completed category when you have non-standard analysis and you have to go to the limit properly. But my point was to show you, just on this example, formulas become better. Usually people, instead of entropy, write some letters, which again, for me, impossible because I never remember which, and they were different in different period of time. I think Boltzmann using S, today people use H, but if there are formulas like that, you don't need this. Yeah, this is the most complicated formula you ever use. Right? But if you start elaborating this junk, of course, you have long formulas and you're forced to, you know, to be in one line to use one letter.
So but how to take
the square root? What square root? There is no square root here. Huh?
It's a relation.
No, there is no square root here. I mean, okay. It's about numbers. Yeah, it's another story. So this is just another related formula for these kind of diagrams, which is useful. And coming back to this original example, so what actually is proven here, was Shannon inequality and another kind of obvious inequality, which I want to say, that entropy of any measure space is less or equal than the log of the cardinality of the space. Inequality holds even on if it's homogeneous. Yeah. This again, true by the same logic. Yeah. You go to this limit and see what happens one space embeds into another. Right? You don't have to make any computation with log. However, and here we should admit that this formalism with about formulas has disadvantage. You cannot prove the equality holds only for homogeneous spaces, right? Because you do it by approximation, and you go, and for this, you need something like Boltzmann formula. You need analyticity of log. Not much, but in order to have extremal case, you need analyticity of log. So log has a deep meaning. And why you take log, by the way? Why you take log? For physicists, it's reasonable, because you have two junk of matter, which are separate. You want entropy to be additive. Rather multiple, like mass, it behaves like energy or like mass. It's additive, and it's reasonable. But why mathematically you take log? Yeah. And there is not explanation, but some phenomenon which tells it's the right thing to do, right? And it's Fisher metric, and but it's not that kind of deep reason that I have only guess what it is, yeah. But I say it in a short while. But now, so we have this property, and now coming back to this Lewis-Whitney inequality. In fact, much stronger inequality is true. Namely, instead of projection of this, you can see the entropies. So here, because you have just first, you can think everything is discrete or continuous. I mean, just I haven't described this formalism for continuous thing. You can do it, or you can approximate everything by discrete, thinking this was subset and discrete measure space, then, because subset, cardinality, and entropy are the same. But projection you can replace by entropies, which are smaller than cardinalities. I mean, than log of it. If still inequality holds true. So it becomes stronger inequality. And when you come to analysis, this corresponds to so-called log Sobolev inequalities, which were proven later, and which is a kind of strengthening of usual Sobolev inequality. So this contains much more meat. But again, there is a big mystery for me, the problem what happens with this ball. There is no similar theorem for ball being extremal. There is no sharp log Sobolev inequality where extremal thing will be ball. It will be only the best you can do and will be Gaussian distribution, sort of, but not the ball, which also quite non-trivial. But anyway, and so if you write the Shannon inequality in this example, actually it's relative Shannon inequality. This gives you this inequality. And so in this kind of limiting argument, of course, it's much easier for me each time to repeat this limiting argument. You go to the limit and you see constant sets and you know the answers. You don't have to remember formulas. All you have to know that cardinality of a subset is smaller than cardinality of a set, and this is just, you know, all kind of the only formula you have to know. Now, how from there we go to next step? Because we had infinite system, and what are the entropy of this infinite system? And my infinite system was a crystal, right? So I have this 3G lattice. So I had this lattice, and I had at each node, I had a particle, and I imagine each particle may be finitely many states. So I have this finite measure space in each point, and I have this infinite product. So I have this finite measure space to the power, this is infinite power. So this is infinite countable set, unlike finite set. What it is? What kind of object is this? So what are these products? And again, so what you say in this kind of categorical language, well, you just say what are your admissible morphisms to finite dimensional space, and the basic of them are projections. And this all you have to know, there may be others. Right? And from that, I want to define entropy and to prove this theorem of Kolmogorov. So now let me remind this theorem of Kolmogorov, which was a problem for quite a while, which is in traditional language of measure theory, but in this way prove, in the formally speaking, more general theorem. But it's formally, in reality, it is the same. So it says, given finite measure space, and Kolmogorov was concerned with the case of integers, and take another measure space, finite measure, take g to the q, so all sequences, so this p is collection of atoms, and this is collection of some atoms, q. So I have sequences of weight p or weight q. For example, the easiest maybe, this have two atoms of equal weight and these three atoms of equal weight. And the question in ergodic theory, if there is isomorphism between theoretic isomorphism between two spaces, which commutes with the action of the group. Right? So when you have a space with an action of the group, it gives you a new category, which is morphism commuting with the action of this group. Right, just again, a general categorical construction, and you want in this particular instance to know that. And it was unknown, just for this example. And Kolmogorov shown that such isomorphism, if such isomorphism is possible, it would imply that entropy of P equals the entropy of Q. This was his theorem, and you can ask the same theorem for any group G. So substitute here by any countable group. And it's unknown. It's still unknown. Though, as I said recently, was a great progress made by Lewis Boyne. Really made next step in that. But Kolmogorov proved for Z and kind of, yes, I explained to you, everything is just, you know, the same for Z or for this group, is just a reasonable difference. And it's unclear to me if it was not known already to physicists or not. Because they were never, of course, looking about Z, it's one-dimensional system, who cares, without interaction. I mean, you can't imagine physicists being concerned with a system of particles on a one-dimensional crystal, don't interact. I mean, it's not a really exciting system. They were studying three-dimensional system with interaction. And there was a big literature preceding that of Kolmogorov, essentially by Van Hoff. And they're proving very kind of deep theorems, much more complicated than that. But if they implicitly had this invariance, the result is unclear to me, because I haven't read these papers, of course. You have to read them and to understand them, which is different language, which is not so obvious. This, I'm curious, yeah, if this was, physicists knew that. But this was a short gap. This was 58, and this paper was in Van Hoffen early 50s, yeah.
You said countable, but you
It's countable generated group is countable.
Is it true?
It's the same. Countable group and countable generated group are the same class of groups. In particular, finitely generated will be countable.
No, is it not? You said it's not.
Yeah, it's countable group. All they say is countable group.
But I'm asking, is it known?
It's unknown for finitely generated group.
No.
It's unknown. It's known for all kind of examples of group. Nobody can show me a group. It's unknown. Because this theorem of Boyne, I mean, not the, yes, there are potential candidates of groups. Maybe it's not true. But any group kind of you show it's. But again, it's related to some other question in group theory, exactly about these non-standard models. So the proof goes, why non-standard analysis? Here, non-standard analysis is absolutely kind of crucial, but not for Kolmogorov case. So let me explain this Kolmogorov case very easy. But again, we just look in crystals. I think the difficulty when you have the group Z and you know, it's too primitive, too simple to say anything. Yeah. Z3 is much more fun. Actually, I prefer lattice, yeah, Z2, yeah. And you can make pictures. So we have to, in principle, define what entropy means of this kind of physical system. And what you do, yeah, actually I have to already some. I can have to wait here. So there's some formulas and just explain what it means. Certainly your system is infinite, right? And so you and since it's infinite, of course entropy must be infinite. So you have to normalize it to the piece. So you have a kind of huge crystal, you take some big chunk of matter, so it becomes finite. Right, so you take entropy of this piece, right? And just imagine this, what you observe under this piece. See what you see there. Take this entropy and divide it by the total number of atoms or by the volume, whatever, normalize, and go to the limit. Limit may exist or may not exist. If not, there is no limit, the sublimit. But in physics, limit should exist. Yeah, in these examples, limit usually exists. And if you have a crystal, then of course you're aided by the symmetry. So you can always kind of, you know, so the kind of this piece and a bigger piece, moved piece, must have the same entropy. So this thing will be kind of invariant when you go to the limit. But the problem is, so how you kind of, you make this a measurement. When you have this in practical, so this big piece, meaning you attach to this your kind of so you, as I said, we have this detector, and we can move this detector along with the symmetry group, right? So I have this detector, it's finite measure space, and I can move it along, and I can move it to a new position and have this P times P, and I can make it many, many times, and take this measurement, and then normalize, right? So see how many states I see. But the point is, of course, when I do that, right? So I cover this chunk of matter by this piece, measure this entropy, whatever I see here, and then it grows. But the point is, I can miss some of the states. My measurement may be blind to some states. You're just missing them. So I can add another kind of more powerful detector and measures them together. And then I may see more. And this is one of the points of the thesis. The entropy is what you see, is not what's in there. There is no entropy in physics of a system. It's completely absurd, yeah, because it's kind of, if you start looking deeper and deeper, it becomes infinite anyway, yeah. Depends how much degree of freedom you measure. For example, it depends on the energy scale. It's just not the states which are there, but the states you can observe and which exchange all the time. If they don't exchange, you don't see them, right? You only see the state when it goes from one to another, energy being committed or absorbed, right? And it's again, by the way, not so easy to formalize mathematically. Yes, my formalization is only partial, right? But at least you go away from this naive set theory, right? So it is, in fact, entropy depends on the class of measurements. And if you say not only measuring, but their protocols. So it will be two categories, not one category, which I don't exactly know how to formalize, but this may be not, may give you somewhat different kind of theory. And essential point is how many kind of these P's you need for that, right? And you say, huh? So I'm kind of in a good shape. If I have a complete system of these detectors, if I add a new one and start measurement with them in the limit, I get the same entropy. So which means that if I get this Q and measure it with kind of with P and then take this many, many times, my entropy up to order n, because it grows proportional to the number of terms, will be the same as if I had no Q. Right? So if I add this new apparatus, all I see, which was already I have seen. Of course, if I start hitting my physical system with much stronger energy, I will see more and more. But on a particular level, I see the same. So mathematically, it means that my kind of measures, abstract measure space, as a functor, is determined by morphism only to these spaces. I don't need extra spaces. Of course, I may change it. I mean, it depends how I look at this. Yeah, this is exactly. I'm saying there is no set. And there are different functors. And different functors on the same physical system can give you different objects. And then the point in particularly in the case of this of product spaces, that, as I said, by their definition, we have infinite product space, P to the power countable set S, right? If I then the projection to finite subset give you full system of measurements, right? If I consider any kind of this join of these sets, if I add any other set, my entropy doesn't grow. So when I measure entropy, and this has nothing to do with ergodic theory, whatever. It's just general property. It's more or less definition of the product. And in the classical measure theory, it's called Lebesgue density theorem. But this is essentially definition of measure, right? It has nothing to do with ergodic theory. The moment I have it, now I can measure my entropy, say in the case of group Z, yeah? So I just measure this entropy on this segment, and then this sum entropy will be original entropy to the power P to the N, right? And the P to the N, this entropy just multiplies by N. And if I have a Q, it will be Q to the N. If the isomorphic, this entropy must be equal. And because kind of the error term, because the group is amenable. So the only thing which is used here, that n plus I divided by n goes to 1 for n going to infinity. And this is a just mathematical part of the Kolmogorov theorem. Everything else is just this kind of categorical language. And where kind of mathematical structure enters, amazingly, there, in this amenability of the group Z.
So is this true for amenable groups?
This is true for amenable groups. This is theorem of Kolmogorov. And if you look a little bit closer, it's immediately what it shows. And this kind of interesting story, what it shows, that if you have amenable group A, and have P, and have Q, and just have a morphism like that. So I'm sorry, I wrote it in the wrong order. You have spaces P to the power A, and Q to the power A, gamma is amenable group, then entropy of P greater equal to the entropy of Q. In particular, if they are isomorphic, the entropy are equal, if the group gamma is amenable. And that's how the story was till relatively recently, because it was observed by Weiss and, I keep forgetting his name, second name, that it is not true for free groups. So if you have a free group, they are quite easy to construct such morphisms which actually increase entropy. And therefore, it was believed that the Kolmogorov theorem is also not true. And then it was about a couple of years ago proven by Bowen for free groups and for some larger class of groups, which I'm going to describe now. that nevertheless it is true. This is not true. This surjectivity entropy is not monotone, but it is still invariant of anti-isomorphism, but for the reason of kind of injectivity of certain auxiliary map, not of their surjectivity. And again, the proof is technical, I will not explain it. Yeah, actually, now they appeared in his latest papers more transparent proof, which I haven't read. His first proof is rather messy. Which, I mean, the idea is clear, but they're computational indeed. Yeah, it's combinatorial computation you have to make. But so, what is the point is that there is a class of group where p to the gamma isomorphic to q to the gamma does imply that entropy is equal. And so now a couple of words, I want to say a few words about these groups. So these groups include free group, and it groups all subgroups of linear groups, and in more general what is called residually finite groups. And so let me define this in a suitable language, just to give the idea where this non-standard analysis enters. And first, what is a residually finite group? From this perspective. So these are groups gamma, which may isometrically act on a compact metric space. If I'm not mistaken, yeah? This is kind of not usual definition, but this definition which is suitable for my purpose. And the logic of that, the way you have to think about that this, when it acts on a compact space, it acts approximately on finite set. Yeah, because if you cover it by finite set, you'll get an approximate action on finite set, and with certain effort, you make it actually acting on finite set. Right? So residually finite group, the ones whose action on finite set fully kind of discloses the nature of the group. And the groups here, they're called surface groups. Which, by definition, which in a second I shall explain it in simple terms, but this is a kind of very good one, the isometry groups over non-standard compact spaces. So you have to say what is a non-standard compact space is. A non-standard compact space is a compact space in the category of non-standard metric spaces, which means objects in, when you take non-standard model of the language of R, of real numbers. So when you have real numbers kind of in your statements, yeah? And so metric is still understood as a real number, but spaces are non-standard. So the idea behind it that these are groups which approximately act on finite sets, but they act in a different way from the one which described here. So let me give the definition due to Weiss. And so there is a surface groups. Probably it's a very restrictive condition. So all amenable groups are surface. All residually finite groups are surface. Projective limits are surface groups are surface. But, well, so kind of residually amenable groups are surface. But there are more examples, but we don't know if the all groups are surface. It's very unlikely they're all surface. And the definition is quite simple. So if you kind of decipher this non-standard language, which to which I was referring already in some categorical sense, it means that again it's convenient to have kind of one infinitely large number. This number of course goes to infinity, but imagine you have this huge number, which is finite but large. Yeah. So you see, just in this boundary between finite and infinite is not that clear. I mean, just mathematical formalism. Yeah, we think we know what is a finite, what is infinite. But let me give an example, which is a typical example which is number which you cannot say whether it's finite or infinite, you consider, say, the time, the maximal time of working of a Turing machine with a program, you know, with the 2,000 bits or million bits, whatever. Right? You describe whatever model you take for your computer with infinite tape, any model you take, and then you write a program and it may go forever or may stop. You consider only those which stop, see how long it takes, and take the supremum of all programs of given lengths sufficiently large. And from some moment on, it's immaterial how large they are, because all these numbers, for all practical purposes, are infinite. They're finite in one language and infinite in another, and this is called, you know, Gödel theorem. That is show that the kind of our picture of naive picture of finite numbers is not adequate. So, and this is exactly what kind of number you take. You take this kind of huge number, this finite set of this cardinality. And the group acts approximately, meaning that it, for given finite set of the group, these elements presented by transformation which are partially defined and which partially satisfy relation, but by the order, the number of elements where they fail to be action divided by the number of elements infinitesimally small, right? So perhaps so when you go to the limit, it becomes small. So they act up to, countingly up to a certain error. And then, of course, this depends on your non-standard model, and with every such model, Born introduced his entropy, but in the case of Bernoulli shift, they all coincide with the usual entropy. But this is the proof of this is not easy, even for free group, even for rigidly finite group. His proof is computational. Unlike Kolmogorov theorem, you have to really compute to see how many combinations are there and why, how they match, etc. Okay, now I want to justify log. Why there is log So again, but this problem, even it's true for all groups, regardless if all groups are, it's unknown if Sophie groups, if you don't leave, if non-Sophie group violates this property, and it's unknown if all groups are Sophic, and so it's very unclear what happens in general with this question, yeah, whether isomorphism implies equality of the entropies. This looks like kind of a rather nice, simple question, yeah, because it's so general. So I repeat, so we have a infinite product of finite measure space indexed by gamma. And the group X here, you consider two such spaces. And if the isomorphism, measure strategic isomorphism preserving the group, commuting with the group action implies the two entropies are equal. And this is a wide open for general groups, with general countable groups. Yeah, that's, I think, it's a very nice question because it's so simple and looks quite difficult. And again, the two major results here. One is due to Kolmogorov, another to Boyan. By the way, in amenable group, in particular, in that case, one knows that converse also true. It is a theorem of what his name. What is his name? Who proven that if entropies are equal, then the thing is isomorphic. I keep forgetting his name always. Oh, in a second. It just came to my mind and then disappeared, yeah. And this kind of part actually easier. The theorem originally was much harder, but when it was proven, Ornstein, yeah, exactly, Ornstein, yeah, it's Ornstein theorem. It's Ornstein theorem is a much more elaborate proof than Kolmogorov. But once it was proven, there was some general lemma, and then it extends to other groups rather effortlessly. Yeah, whenever a group has a kind of free abelian subgroups, it's already true. It happens to be as one could expect it. Yeah, it's harder to prove, but you know, having much less structure inside, this remains unknown. Now about log. Now let me. And this actually has also a certain relation to mathematical biology, which I don't know, I must admit, though this concept comes from mathematical biology, what I'm going to say originates in mathematical biology. And there are two names, And so the major player here was Fisher. And so this is about log at Shannon inequality. If you think a little bit about Shannon inequality, indeed it easily transforms to the fact that entropy is, I keep forgetting, convex or concave function in the variables pi. So if you have p1, pn, I hate this notation. And so you think about them as a point in the n simplex, n plus p0, pn. So I have unit simplex given. So they're positive numbers, sum equals 1. So entropy is some function of the simplex to positive real. And Shannon inequality is kind of equivalent. Again, when you say equivalent, it's still simple reduction, but in certain contexts, it may be equivalent, sometimes not. That this function being, I keep forgetting, convex or concave. And I think convex. Yeah. It's minus entropy is convex, entropy is concave. I prefer this function, which is convex. But this will be negative, yeah. But it's material. So it's positive or convex or concave, but what essentially it's Hessian, it's sign definite. So you can always turn it into positive. So it defines positive definite quadratic form on the simplex. So this is Hessian of this entropy. So it's a differential quadratic form, which is positive definite, therefore it is a metric. So it's a Riemannian metric. And and you may ask, what kind of metric is this? Yeah, if you know this metric, it's complete, not complete, positive curvature, negative curvature. So what kind of metric is this? And just my experience again, when I just thought about it, I asked somebody, and he said to me, this is called Shanshahani metric. And then from this moment on, you can start searching internet, yeah? Shanshahani is a mathematical biologist who introduced this metric about 30 years ago. And when just I look into that, and there were about 10 other names attached to this. People were discovering it all the time, this metric, and discussing it. I think the first was Fisher in something 1923, maybe, or something. And then I still couldn't figure out what kind of metric this was. But then I read in some, by somebody who apparently discovered this metric himself. It was annoyed. It was called Shanshahani. He said, why is it called Shanshahani metric? It's just spherical metric. So this metric is isometric. The simplex isometric to the simplex in the sphere. If you take sphere in this positive cone, with this metric, simplex isometric to the spherical metric. So we take Hessian of this function, sum of pi log pi. Why it will be of constant curvature? It's incredible this can be, by the way, right? This is not so what's so remarkable, it has so high degree of symmetry. This only has symmetry of permutation group. This has symmetry of the orthogonal group. How could it be? And so what is the map? What is the isometry between them? And the isometry is not radial projection. If you take radial projection, it's not isometry. But what is the projection in the map, which is called Archimedes map, when you have coordinates xi, they go to xi squared. Then the points on the sphere where sum squared is 1 goes to simplex where the sum is 1, right? So this maps sphere Sn to the simplex. Right, because here, if some, what mean being on the sphere? On the sphere means sum of x squared equals 1. What mean being on the simplex? It's sum, so this quote yi equal. It means sum of yi equals 1. So, and this map gives a symmetry, just obvious kind of. If you make computation, it's immediately sheer, the symmetric, up to a constant b2 or something. And this map is what is called a real part of the moment map. And again, the moment map is a kind of a remarkable map, a mathematic discovered by Archimedes, who discovered that when you project sphere to the interval, this map is measure preserving. And in more kind of in fancy terms, it has the map for complex numbers from z to z times z bar. The map from C to positive numbers is also measure preserving. They're not one-to-one map, they're not preserved density, but they're preserved measure, yeah, in the category of measure spaces. And so this is the map, and then immediate kind of tendency, immediate kind of conclusion is that entropy must be invariant under the group of orthogonal transformations. And this entropy was introduced by von Neumann, and so how it is defined? What are the objects where it is defined? So you have to say, yes, all the thing about measure spaces, but in a way it will be orthogonally invariant. So let's do that. We say it in a slightly fancy way, but it's kind of nice, yeah. And corresponding to the spirit of quantum mechanics. So the point is that what I want to say that just from this Boltzmann formula implies the existence of quantum mechanics mathematically. And this is kind of, you know, I don't see a rational explanation for that. Why statistics and the formula which came from just kind of formalism of the law of large numbers, which is the only mathematics there, or the rest is the language. Why the law of large numbers imply the existence of orthogonal symmetry in the space? You see, if it were the normal law, we kind of know this, yeah? But why the law of large numbers? That's, for me, unclear. However, once this being said, how we define entropy in this Euclidean setting? So measures on finite set, it's something when you numbers assigned to subsets, and they have some property invariant under permutation or something, right? So what will be this in the case of a when you replace sets by Hilbert spaces, yeah? So kind of formalism for Neumann, at least formalism quantum mechanics, is you just anything instead of sets, say finite sets, you replace finite dimensional Euclidean spaces, infinite sets by infinite dimensional spaces. You may do it over real or over complex numbers, it makes no difference, yeah? This mathematically it's the same. I mean, it's one, in this particular case, if you know it for real, you know it for complex, and vice versa. So instead of having finite set, you have a Hilbert space, and you want to introduce something like a measure. But what you would be measuring is to subsets, you have subspaces. And to each subspace, you want to assign a number in Hilbert space. And the condition of additivity is that if the two spaces are orthogonal, this is additive. These things add up. And the whole thing must be, of course, unitary, have kind of a certain degree of symmetry a posteriori. And the way to do it is as follows. And it may be positive, it must be additive, and there is, in a way, if you look at these kind of properties, there is only one solution. And solution will be as following. You take positive definite quadratic form, and you now normalize it, trace to B1, right? Sum of eigenvalues 1. And then, if you want to measure it, it's kind of using this form, and this will be a measure. So these are called in physics density matrices. And usually they're in complex Hilbert space, but real is as good for us as complex. So the symmetric, the positive definite matrix with trace 1. Given a subspace that's restricted there, take trace over there. And this will be the mass. And this is additive by Pythagorean theorem. Of course, everything, of course, is Pythagorean theorem. Right? You replace. So the point is you replace additivity, kind of, the fact that kind of additivity of cardinalities replaced by Pythagorean theorem. Of course, all this formalism in Hilbert spaces is just kind of unfolding of Pythagorean theorem. And so, and this is essential property, that this additive, and this, as I said, is Pythagorean theorem. Actually, this property of this Archimedes theorem, the property of this preservation of measures, is also integration obtained by integration of Pythagorean theorem. So it's kind of fundamental extension of additivity to linear algebra. So, and so what will be then the entropy of that? And of course, the kind of the naive definition of the entropy, so the objects are replacing measures are positive definite quadratic forms. These are measure spaces. Yeah. The positive definite quadratic forms with sum of eigenvalues trace equal 1. Yes. This point total mass equal 1. So-called density matrices. And in particular, kind of another manifestation of Pythagorean theorem, if you take a autonomous frame, any autonomous frame, and take the sum of values of the form, it doesn't depend on the frame. Right? It's, again, exactly because of orthogonality, it adds up and it doesn't depend. It doesn't depend on the frame. This additivity is very strong, yeah, because this additivity implies you can decompose it many ways and get the same number. It's much more symmetry than in the usual measures. So what would be entropy? And von Neumann defines entropy as, so we have this eigenvalues, and you can say again, it will be the same, this will be your kind of weight, so it will be lambda I log lambda I with minus sign. And so it will be just, you take diagonalized matrix, it becomes a finite measure space, you take entropy of this measure space. And then you want to prove, kind of the basic properties of this Shannon type inequality in developer ergodic theory, and then it's become not completely obvious. So that's interesting, that it's not completely obvious. And so let me show you kind of one way to formulate it. And so, so the point is that in quantum mechanics, and this is just you see also in mathematically, there is no concept of going from a bigger system to a small system, right? In physics, in classical physics, there is a reduction. You have our big system, you make a measurement, and you go to the smaller system. But in quantum mechanics, it doesn't quite work because big system is not, in the simplest example, kind of classical thing, you have a big system, and you can project this to A, the small one. And this is a reduction maps. In quantum mechanics, the corresponding thing will be tensor product of spaces. So, because corresponding quantum mechanical object has spaces of function on A and B. So this will be this tensor product. And then you don't have, this doesn't exist. You can't reduce it. And this kind of physically has some meaning. Yeah, yes, the quantum world, universe, not divisible. Yes, you cannot have isolated quantum mechanical system. This thing doesn't exist. By physical, whatever physicists mean by that, but this is what they say, and mathematically it means that. Actually, you remember we had it in this Mendelian formalism because the spaces were coming with additional structure. There were some, because you could kind of, there were spaces of function and you could integrate over the spaces. This integral was particularly functional, allowing this projection. But this, in principle, here is not allowed. What you can do, however, you can symmetrize the states, yeah? So your states, or your probability distribution states, if you have a group acting on a space by orthogonal transformation, you can apply this group and average and you have something. And this systematically what happens in the world, you have this averaging. And this is almost the same as reduction in classical case, because if you have this kind of bunch of numbers, and you want to project it here. This projection is prohibited in quantum mechanical world. However, imagine you have a group acting, permuting them in this all these fibers. If you average them, they become constant along the fibers. And then as good as have projection. Right? You can go from one to another, all formulas become instantaneous. So taking this picture having this picture in mind, we can ask about Shannon inequality when you apply this. And this here state the basic inequality. Shannon inequality. Here it is. This was proven by Lanford and Robinson about 40 or 50 years ago, that how entropy behaves under this averaging. If you look what happens in this example, in this classical example, it becomes Shannon inequality. And here there is a condition. Commuting is OK, but these are irreducible. And you may ask, why the hell irreducible? The proof is not terribly difficult, not terribly easy. It's still relatively simple. It was proven. And then conjecture was, it's formulated differently. They formulated in a more traditional physical language. But in what I say, of course, this was obviously annoying condition. And the conjecture, it's unneeded, which corresponds essentially, in the slightly different language, they had absolute Shannon inequality, and you wanted relative inequality in for morphisms, because here there is no morphisms. But this corresponds to irreducibility. The trouble with reducible, not that there are many components, but some components go in multiples. And when they go in multiples, these multiples completely can mix up. You know, if you have a reducible representation when one thing appears many, many times, and this is what happens in these examples, and then you can kind of, there's too many symmetries, and this is a really different picture. And then it was proven 5 years later by Lieb and Ruskai. And so this is true without this condition. And this kind of basic fact here. And in one way to see the proof is exactly along this line, which I said. You have to redefine entropy the same way we did it for the finite set. You have your Hilbert space and where there is matrix Q. But now you take it tensorial power when n is, again, non-standard number, infinite number. And just start arguing everything, reformulating in this term. And again, by the law of large numbers, this matrix become quasi-homogeneous. Well, this quasi is a little bit kind of annoying point, which means that in the limit, in the approximate approximation, it will have the following nature. Here you have a homogeneous object, meaning proportional to your Hilbert original form. All eigenvalues are equal, and projection to this subspace. But the fact that you have this projection, it means not the whole space. There is kernel, right? So the subspace where it vanishes, semi-definite, non-definite. And this is a kind of little point which makes arguments slightly trickier. However, if you just assume that your objects are like that, all before and after averaging are quasi-homogeneous, and then become kind of tautology, the same way as for sets, for different reasons, but you make this computation and it's just obviously equal. The only thing that to check it's really correct, that this operation is sufficiently functorial to survive all kind of, because you see, this what was important in classical case, that not only Bernoulli theorem was true for objects, it's true for morphisms, yeah? So you could coherently go to the homogeneous limits. And here also you have to show you can go coherently. But this coherence is kind of, well, you have to say exactly what it is. And so it takes a couple of pages on one hand. On the other hand, the proofs, which traditionally done by this kind of, what is now is called matrix convexity, which was kind of this term appeared later, that the whole theory of convexity, in particular convex function, has their counterpart for operators. And it's different kind of convexity, which is stable under tensor product, which I must admit I don't know too much. Yeah, but this is a kind of interesting enough thing. Yeah. Okay, so this is the end of the story about the entropy.